Anybody who's doing ministry needs calling, needs anointing, needs gifting and all. They need special gifts. I'm not trying to put that down. I am saying there is something greater than anointing, calling and gifts. That is the name of Jesus.
Hide me now under your
Does Peter not have power or godliness? Is Peter lacking in power? Now think about Peter. Who is Peter? Peter is like the leader of the disciples. He's no ordinary man, you see. You know, they say Peter is the first pope. You know, that's the kind of respect that is given to Peter, you know. Peter is no ordinary guy, my friend. He had all the power. He had, if you want to talk about anointing, I don't think you can tell me anybody living today has more anointing than Peter had. Can you tell me that this person who was, you know, here today has more anointing than Peter himself? I don't think we can say something like that, right? Anybody with anointing today, Peter can match that. I think his anointing would probably be greater. Anybody with calling, Peter can match that. Anybody who says, I have special gifts, come to me. I think Peter can. You think Peter didn't have special gifts? The gift of healing? You think he didn't have that? He had that, you see. But he says, this miracle did not happen because of my gift. It did not happen because of my anointing. It did not happen because of my calling. It did not happen because of me. Or my godliness, my holiness, right? Sometimes we think we are committing these sins, but the preacher is very, very pure, holy, holy, you know. So let's go to him. If he prays, God will listen. Can you tell me that Peter is lacking in holiness? Did Peter not have holiness? No, Peter had holiness. You see, he was ready to give everything for Jesus. Yes, he betrayed him and all that, but I'm talking about by the end of his life, Peter was a mighty man. Just even now, he was a mighty man, you see. At the end, they crucified him upside down. That's how much he was ready to give everything to Jesus. You think he was not holy, my friend? He can match any holiness standard that you put up to him, you see. Peter was no ordinary guy. He had the power, he had the holiness. But he says, the miracle did not happen because of my power or because of my holiness. But here the preachers today are saying, you come to me, my anointing is great and it will change your, it will give you the healing, it will give you this, you know. What will give you? My anointing, my special gifts. Come to me, write to me, call me, 24-hour call line. You know, all that is fine. But what I'm trying to compare those things to the, to what? To the name of Jesus. You see, he says it did not happen. This great miracle did not happen because I'm a great disciple. I'm the leader of the disciples, the first pope with great anointing, special gifts. No, it happened. Verse 16 once again. Why did it happen? His name through faith in his name. This is something we need to catch today, you see. Why? Oftentimes when we have a problem today, we look to the preacher, the pastor, the evangelist. We go to them thinking they can do something. Why? They have more power than us. They have more anointing than the common believer, we think, right? They are called specially for ministry, given special gifts, therefore they can do something. See, that is how we think. When we have a problem, that is how we think. Let's go to the pastor, let him pray. Peter is saying, I'm not so special. My anointing, my gifts did not do the miracle. My holiness did not do the miracle. Did the miracle happen because Peter was extra holy the previous day? No. You see, this is how we think sometimes, but. You see, he says, no, not me. It's the name. It's the faith in that name, you see. I want you to get this, you see. There is a great emphasis on the name, so much so that the passage downplays, belittles, or even disparages, you know, puts Peter and John down to lift up the name of Jesus. I'm going to show you. The passage actually puts them down and lifts up the name of Jesus, you see. If you continue reading chapter 3, Peter tells them very clearly how the miracle happened. It's not my power, my godliness. It happened because of Jesus' name and through faith in his name. And then he continues preaching, okay? And then we come to the end of that chapter. And then look at chapter 4, verse 1. Now as they spoke to the people, the priest, the captain of the temple, and the Sadducees came upon them. Now these priests, right? Remember, they're at the temple. They have priests over there, right? They're pastors. Priests or pastors. Those are the guys usually doing the preaching. Suddenly here, Peter is doing preaching, you know. So they all come and see what's going on. Not only the priests, the captain of the temple had like a security force, a police force. The captain of that police force came and they take Peter and John. Look at verse 3. They laid hands on them, put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. So they take Peter and John, they take them and put them in jail. And then the next day, verse 5. And it came to pass on the next day that their rulers, elders, and scribes. Notice the words rulers, elders, and. Now these are big people, right? Who are they? Let's see. As well as Annas, verse 6. Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John, Alexander. Do you recognize any of these names? Caiaphas. And these are some of these guys are the same guys who crucified Jesus a few days ago in the same city of Jerusalem. Right? This miracle is happening in Jerusalem in the temple. This is exactly just outside, on the outskirts of Jerusalem. They crucified Jesus. Caiaphas, the high priest, was heavily involved in that. He was the one, you know, responsible for that. These same people are all now gathering. The great rulers, elders, and scribes, the high priest and their family, and everybody is gathering together at Jerusalem. Verse 7, when they had set them in their midst, they asked, so they all gathered together. We are talking about the most powerful people in the land, in Jerusalem. The most powerful politicians, religious leaders, all the great leaders of Jerusalem are gathering together to question Peter and John. Right? And look at their question, verse 7. When they had set them in the midst, they asked, by what power or by what name have you? Look at how they put it. By what power or by what name? You see that? They understand that name can have power. By what power or by what? Peter and John, you have done a great thing. Tell us how you did it. What is that power which caused it? Or what is that name at least? Tell us, they're saying. Then verse 8, Peter answers them. Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, begins to answer them. Let's go to verse 10. I want you to see that answer. Let it be known to you all, verse 10, and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man stands here before you whole. Peter says, you want to know by what power I did it? By what name? Let me tell you very clearly. The name of Jesus Christ. By the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. You know that fellow you crucified a few days ago? And God raised that person up? You know he came from Nazareth. That Jesus. Peter is very specific. He doesn't want them to miss it. You asked by what name? Let me tell you very specifically. By Jesus Christ of Nazareth. By his name, by him, this man stands before you whole. So they ask him, Peter tells them. Did they believe Peter? Look in verse 13. Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men, they marveled. You see, Peter and John were speaking boldly. Here were the most powerful people of that city questioning them, and these guys are answering boldly, you see. No fear in them. And, you know, if we had seen such a sight, if we were there, we might think, oh, what great anointing, you know. What great powerful men of God, Peter and John. Look what they are saying. Verse 13, they perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men. You see, today we think of Peter as someone great, right? But these guys, the rulers and the elders and the people who crucified Jesus, the high priest, everybody, all of them knew Peter and John very well. You remember, they knew Jesus very well. So they had noted his disciples. They were watching his disciples. They knew Peter was this guy's like the leader. And they know everything about Peter. They know how he started out, you see. They know his background. Peter did not have a great background. He was an ordinary fisherman, you see. Look at how it says it. Uneducated. He did not have any great training. He was not very schooled, very learned, like the Apostle Paul, for example. He was uneducated. And untrained men, in English it comes as untrained men. In the better word is actually gullible. Gullible. A person with no discernment. A person who's easily fooled. Right? You tell something, you know some people are like that. They're very innocent. Right? They don't have much discernment. You tell them something, they'll believe you. These people get fooled in the world easily. Peter was like that, these fellows are saying. See, gullible, easily fooled. That is the type of word, Greek word, that is behind this, you see. According to these great rulers and elders and chief priests and all of them, these men could not have done some great miracle like this. Why? They had no training, no great, they did not go to a big Bible college, you see. No great training. And furthermore, naturally itself, they were gullible, they were easily fooled. They'll believe whatever you say. They don't have much. They're not very smart. That's what he's saying, you see. How can these guys, uneducated, not very smart fellows, how can they speak so boldly? They're very stunned at that. Look at that. When they saw the boldness, they marveled. Why? They know. How can these guys don't have education. These guys don't have, you know, natural, smart thinking. How can they be so bold? And then look at that. It says they realized they had been with Jesus. You may be an ordinary person, you see, but if you're with Jesus long enough, the lack of education, the lack of even natural smartness, the low IQ, all that you'll make up for all of that. Jesus will take you higher and higher despite those things. That's what was happening to Peter and John. They by themselves were not great men, you see. Jesus was the person making them great. So what I want you to notice is these unbelieving enemies of Christ and Christianity, Who am I talking about? The rulers, the elders, the people who crucified Jesus, the high priest and his family and all these people. These people recognized that this miracle could not have happened just by them. Impossible. We know them. We know how they're coming from. They were with Jesus. That's the only possibility. See, they recognize it. And in verse 16, come down to verse 15, they commanded them to go outside the council. They conferred among themselves. So what they did is their question. It's an interrogation, you see. They're questioning Peter and John. Peter and John answering boldly. They're wondering where this boldness came from. They realize it's from Jesus. Then they tell them, okay, step outside for a minute. We want to talk amongst ourselves. And verse 16, they talk amongst themselves. What shall we do to these men? For indeed that a notable miracle has been done throughout them is evident to all who dwell in Jerusalem. And we cannot deny it. They're saying, these guys have done a great miracle. The whole city knows about it. The whole city is talking about it. We can't say it didn't happen, right? Nobody's going to believe us. So what should we do? Verse 17, but so that it spreads no further among the people, let us severely threaten them that from now on they speak to no man in this name. Verse 18, so they called them and commanded them. So they called Peter and John inside and they called them and commanded them not to speak at all nor teach in the name of. They had only one condition for Peter and John, right? These unbelieving enemies of Christ had only one condition. They called Peter and John and they said, Peter, John, you guys go do whatever you want. Have all the meetings you want, the healing meetings, the prayer meetings, all the meetings. Do your ministry. Don't do only one thing. Don't use the name of. Just don't do that. Do whatever you want. One condition. Don't teach the other people the power that is in the name of Jesus. Do whatever else you want. You see, you're welcome to do whatever you want, except, look at the way they say, don't speak at all nor teach in the name of Jesus. You see, these unbelieving enemies of Christ got it. Got what? They know where the power is. They know if these guys go do some ministry without using the name of Jesus, nothing will happen. They know the power for that miracle, the power that surged into those, ankle bones came from where? Not from Peter's anointing, from the name of Jesus. So they're saying, Peter, you do whatever you want. Go use your anointing. Don't use the name of Jesus. That just leave that one thing out. See? See how clear they are in their minds, how the miracle took place. But the believers today are not clear. And the people, yes, that day also. That's why they were surrounding Peter and John, looking at them in amazement. Oh, what great men, you know. Believers today also are looking at the preachers with great amazement. Oh, what a great preacher. What a mighty man of God, you know, with a powerful anointing, with a special gifting, you know. Can do mighty miracles. How does this, you know, how do preachers' anointing and gifting and all these things compare with the name of Jesus, you see? I'm not trying to, you know, talk bad about those things, right? Anointing is important. Without, you know, calling is important. Without calling, a preacher cannot be a preacher. He's not a real preacher at all if he's not called into the ministry. See, without anointing, no preacher can really do ministry. You need an anointing for that. Without gifting, you cannot really do the ministry. So anybody who's doing ministry needs calling, needs anointing, needs gifting and all. They need special gifts. I'm not trying to put that down. I am saying there is something greater than anointing, calling and gifts. That is the name of Jesus. And Peter recognized this, you see. He recognized he has power, he has anointing, he has everything. But there's something greater and he uses that to produce the miracle. That's what you should get, you see. Why am I saying this? Because today when we have a problem, you know, what do we think, you know? We think, let's go to the pastor, let's go to the man of God, let's write him a letter, or let's go and get counseling from him. Those things are not wrong. What I'm saying is there is a better way. There is a higher way, an easier way that you can go and get the answer easily. Get victory. That's what I'm trying to say. You see, what are we trying to talk about today? Use of the name of Jesus. How should we use the name? How often should we use it? How important is it? Well, I'm trying to say it's more important, right? It should be given more importance than your preacher and pastor's anointing and gifting and things like that. What am I trying to say? I'm trying to say, when you have a problem, where do you go first? That's what I'm asking. When you have a problem, how do you think? Shall I go to this pastor? Shall I go to this man of God? Is that what you think? See, that is what I'm referring to. Believers, when they have a problem, you know, if I, you know, you're all sitting there. Just imagine I come to your seat and I pinch you as hard as I can. Right? Pinch you nice and good. Right? Some of us may say, ouch, or something. We're going to say something, you know. When you say, Appa, Amma, what is that show? Just reflex, you know, without even thinking, you're shouting your father's name or your mother's name or something else, right? Today, when people have a problem, they're shouting medicine when the fever comes, you know. Right? What is your first go-to thing? Where do you go first? What do you think about first when the problem comes, when the debt comes, when the family problem comes? Where do you go first? That's what I'm talking about right now. See? We may think, I'm not like the person who goes to the pastor all the time. Fine, you may not be that type of person. But you may be the type of person who goes to the medicine. The headache is there. Fever, why use the name of Jesus, you know? There's the aspirin. The name for fever. Right? Some other problem, well, you have a name for that. I'm talking about everything, my friend. Where do you go to first? When there is a problem, how do you think? Some people run to the pastor, some people run to medicine, some people run to other things. I'm saying, no, use the name of Jesus. Use the promises of God. Use the Spirit of God that's in you. Those are the things that we need to go to first, you see. This is the priority that the name of Jesus must have in our lives. Some people think, you know, I won't use the name of Jesus for small problems. Let me wait for some big problem. I'm reserving it, saving it for the rainy day, you know. When it pours, I'm going to use it. No, it won't work. Sad to. Unfortunately, if you don't use it at all and suddenly use it against a big mountain, generally it won't work. Why? You won't have any faith, you see. Faith will grow only if you use it, you see. You have to use it. When you have the small problems, use it, my friend. At least if it doesn't work, you can put the aspirin, you see. I'm just saying, you know. There it's not life and death. Don't wait for a life and death situation and then say, I'm going to use it, you know. No, use it, you see. You need to get practiced in that, you see. You need to be using it. It needs to have an importance in your everyday life. That's what I'm talking about.
Clap our hands. Resurrection, power of Christ. has overcome. Yes, he has overcome. We will not be shaken. We will not be moved. Jesus, you are here.
I will live.
I will live. I will not die. The resurrection power of Christ alive in me. And I am free in Jesus' name.
Jesus.